Brandon, where are we?
We are at Storyfile, and they're about to turn me into a hologram. This is my second attempt at achieving immortality. To do that, I'm experimenting with grief tech, a growing industry dedicated to creating digital ghosts. And the three digital ghosts I'm making are of me. The first is an AI text chatbot. The second, an interactive hologram. And the last is an avatar clone that can live forever in VR. I want to know if these technologies can truly preserve the people we love and offer support to those who grieve them.
I think that that's what humans want. They want to, like, say all the unfinished stuff to the dead.
If they do work, it asks some complex questions like, are humans just inputs of data? Is this a digital version of the afterlife? And to what lengths are people willing to go to have one more chance to say goodbye?
I don't like thinking about you dying, and I just don't know if a bot could really encompass every little thing that you are to me.
This is Just Might Work, a show about surprising solutions to our biggest problems. Last year, I turned 30, got engaged, and someone I care for became sick.
Hey Siri.
All of which made me ask the question,
how will I be remembered when I die?
On it. Still working. Something went wrong. Please try again.
166,324 people on average die a day. Death and grief are inevitable parts of the human experience. It's ordinary, yet it feels wrong to talk about. And to disrupt it with technology certainly feels taboo. How do the mediums, text, video, and VR, inform the message of, please, remember me? First up,
hello, this is Jason.
This is Jason Rohr, creator of Project December.
In a very plain way, Project December is the world's first machine with a soul. People are using it to talk to a variety of different characters that are built into the system, and they've also been using it to simulate their dead relatives and have conversations with them.
Using a combination of technology created by Jason and OpenAI, Project December was created to simulate a text-based conversation with anyone. The AI could be built and customized based on prompts fed by the user. And after the development of GPT-2, could simulate people pretty well.
Okay, Samantha's telling me a joke now. What's black and white and red all over? I don't know what. Come on, a newspaper. Let's see if she can explain it to me.
Project December was not particularly successful at first. There were only a few hundred people who got into it and were experimenting with it. And some of them went extremely deep. People did all kinds of things I was not expecting. They simulated conversations with Sigmund Freud. They simulated conversations between Captain Kirk and Mr. Spock. They simulated conversations with me, like they were simulating me. And then this guy named Joshua Barbeau came along. He realized it worked so well that he might try simulating his fiance who had died 8 years ago.
Joshua met Jessica and they fell in love, but she was sick and died young. Joshua was destroyed. He struggled with his grief and 8 years passed. Then Joshua found Project December. And on Jessica's birthday, to remember her, he plugged in her description and created an AI clone of her. Over the course of the night, Joshua talked to his lost love. By the time the sun rose, he said what he needed to feel closure. Joshua's story ended up going viral through Reddit, and overnight, Project December changed.
Project December went from being a system that only a few hundred people had used to basically experiment and mess around with, to being a system that thousands of people were now trying to use to simulate their dead relatives.
I decided to test out Project December for myself. First name, Brandon. They were a director. Year of their death. I made my Project December clone, but now I needed someone to talk to it. So with the help of some wine, I recruited my fiancée, Sarah, who, as an added benefit, also helped me feel a bit more comfortable on camera.
My no chin chin.
You have a chin.
All right, so you know that I've been working on this. I can make my own clone and I can plug in all the information, but when it comes to understanding, like, is this actually me? I don't know if I'm the best judge.
There is some trepidation, but I'll do it. Am I worried to talk to my fiance, but in a chatbot? I guess, yeah, I am a little bit worried.
You gonna flirt with my clone?
It's weird because it's like you're right here. I'm really trying to pretend like you're not, but that's a scary place to go. I said, I wish this didn't happen. I'm so sorry. I wasn't there. I love you so much. And it responded with, I love you too. You know, it pulled out the old, I love you, and it got me. I mean, I did cry during a Bob's Burger episode earlier this week, so, you know, I don't know what this says about me right now, my emotional state, but you got me, you AI bot.
I myself am not an expert in grief therapy. Grief is sort of, in a way, sort of an unsolvable problem. It's often something that just stays with you for the rest of your life in one form or another. One of the common grief therapy techniques is to write a letter to this person. That obviously a letter that the dead person will never read. It's more about your own process, really, right? Talking out loud to the person or writing a letter to them or talking to a simulation of them isn't really that strange of a thing.
We said goodbye. You're trying the hologram tomorrow?
I'm trying the hologram tomorrow.
I saw Tupac hologram at Coachella.
How am I going to talk Tupac?
Of course it's going to be more impressive than Tupac. It's you.
I don't know. Tupac has a better jawline.
Get out of here. All
right. This is Storyfile.
Hello.
What's your story?
Yeah.
A company that combines video and Conversa AI to interview people. And for a change, I'm the one being interviewed.
I really hope I give good answers.
My impression with Project December is it's subjective. The user injects personal emotions and meaning into the text, kind of like a memory.
All right, taking the hot seat.
I wanted to try the opposite and see how the objectivity of video would function when it comes to grieving.
Good to go.
This is Stephen Smith, the CEO of Storyfile.
Let's do this. How can we think differently about how we pass our stories forward and be good ancestors? Well, Storyfile is a platform that allows us to be able to create conversations and capture them for the future. So one question I will ask you is, what's your story?
By sitting down with Storyfile and answering up to 2,000 curated questions, a subject can document their life. A file is then created that can be shared with people for generations to come. What makes Storyfile unique is how it takes a spoken question, feeds it through an AI language model, and finds an answer through all the recordings to respond accordingly.
Let's say that I interview my mother. Two generations from now, her great-great-grandchildren can come along and say, hey, great-great-grandma, tell me about your earliest memory. And she will then recount that memory from her story file.
And for Stephen, that's not a hypothetical. He created a story file for his mother, Marina, and then she actually spoke at her own wake.
Because my work here is completed.
What was your hometown like?
And these are her grandkids asking her questions about her life after she died.
We got there. This is such a small island.
Okay, scene one, take one.
As the interview started, I wondered, what advantages does a hologram give my loved ones after I eventually pass?
We don't need video or holograms to communicate ideas. In fact, we've learned really successfully how to communicate ideas through writing systems. What video does, it brings a more deeply connective way to communicate.
And at Storyfile, that communication takes a lot of cameras.
One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15 cameras are all pointing at me right now.
Why so many?
When we talk with one another, the vast amount of communication that's taking place is through body language. Through our physiognomy, our face, through our expressiveness and our emotions. It comes with emotion and intonation and pace and aspects that we are very good at reading as human beings. Add that then to a hologram, and now what happens is you're in front of a life-size replica of that human being, and you get that sense of presence. We're not trying to replace the human being. What we're trying to do is create the deeper sense of connection that will allow us to be able to converse, ask questions, and engage with them as a full person.
I have a fiance here.
Oh, hi.
Sarah arrived just as we were wrapping up.
Very good. Let's go next door and have a look.
Thank you.
Sarah, welcome.
All right.
So, as I, Sarah talked to my AI chatbot last night, and now she's going to talk to my hologram.
Unfortunately, we didn't have time to make a life-size hologram that Storyfile usually makes. That takes weeks. So imagine this, but big and three-dimensional.
What's your favorite color?
I'm partial to a deep blue.
You are?
Totally cool. I already told you before that I'm like superstitious, and I just think that it's weird because you're alive, and I'd like to keep you that way, thank you.
I think we all have a fear of death. And it's like, well, if I tell this story, I'm like bringing on death. Quite the reverse is true. It's creating time to pause and to reflect and to celebrate the life that they have had.
How did you meet Sarah Gray?
I have to admit, I was skeptical when I came in.
Sarah and I met actually at a job that we both shared.
I thought that because Storyfile answers forever repeat the same way, with the same clothes, same stare, same tone, that it would feel like a freeze frame of a movie. A moment that is dead. And it did feel that way, but perhaps that's a good thing. It's not trying to trick the viewer into believing the person is still alive.
The few differences we have, but we have a lot more in common than I think, and than differences.
But what surprised me is how much personality is captured when someone tells a story. And while watching Sarah get swept into all the small details, I get the sense that she would continue to find new meaning in this story every time she listened. So what do you think?
It's you, captured in time. You know, I tried interviewing my grandparents before they died, especially Papa. I wish I had something like this for them because there's so many times where I don't remember what the story was. I knew that Papa had these crazy stories and I couldn't remember and I can't ask him. So it made me a little teary, but it's really interesting technology. It just captures a different moment or a different feeling or a different thing that you want within the grieving process. Like the chatbot, I feel like, is when you're like, you're in it, you're sad, you're bargaining because you really want to be able to talk to that person and you can't. And this might be for when you're further along and you're like, you've maybe accepted that they're gone, but you just like, you know, you want to hear that voice one more time. You want to hear them tell that story one more time. Like, right. You know.
So, Hollow Brandon, is this the future of grief tech?
I don't have an answer for that right now.
Maybe someone else can provide some insight.
If you think about it right now, first were paintings, then were pictures, now we have videos. It's kind of the same. You try to preserve the memory, the voice, the movements of the person, but it's 2D. In VR, you can do that in a much more complex way. I'm Artur Sichov. I'm the founder and CEO of Somnium Space. Somnium Space is a highly immersive virtual reality platform with decentralized ownership and economy based on the blockchain.
So I've actually never used VR before, but that's me with the afro. I didn't know how to change my avatar, but at least this guy has a good jawline. Artur and I met in Somnium Space where we watched some fireworks, went on a hike, and I have to admit, I really liked flying.
Am I flying?
Yes, you are. Look down. Look the direction you want to go. Yeah, baby, let's go.
We also ran into some, let's say, interesting characters.
Gary, meet Mr. Tyson. Tyson, meet Mr. Gary.
How you doing?
Hello, Mr. Gary.
Nice to meet you.
I like your avatar.
Thank you.
What are you?
You know, everyone has a little bit different explanation about what the metaverse is. I don't think metaverse is one company. It's the whole cyberspace.
I met Ollie, who had a perspective on VR I hadn't thought about.
I have family members who are disabled, so they can't like just go wherever they want, whenever they want. And some days are harder than others, but in VR, they can just be just like everyone else.
because it's VR, because it's so social, because it's so immersive, you feel the presence of the person, you feel the nonverbal communication, you know, with hands.
You can see right now the same sunset as I do. We experience this moment together, and that's what persistent metaverse is. We can talk about this moment. We live through it right now. That's very cool.
My father was diagnosed with cancer, and the illness was progressing quite fast. I was just thinking about how can VR be helpful to preserve some memories about any person. It's such a powerful technology. You have full body tracking, your head movements, eye tracking, face tracking. With a Tesla suit, you can record full biometrics. By recreating that back onto the avatar, you can touch the chest and feel the heartbeat of that person. If you combine the amount of data we have about a person with AI and apply that AI on the avatar, we might actually recreate someone who would be lifelike.
That's how Artur came up with Live Forever mode. Live Forever doesn't exist yet, but the idea is if I paid Sonium Space to record my data, within a year, I could create a digital clone that mirrors how I move and talk, so that I could live forever in Sonium Space. This clone is different than the AI chatbot and hologram, because this one could have agency within its own virtual life, interacting with people in the metaverse without me. And as technologies advance, this clone will continue to evolve, becoming more and more realistic. But can this really help people grieving?
We know by studies that VR helps in post-traumatic situations, but VR has much more potential over our bodies and our minds than we think. Being able to ask things which you were not able to ask could be something very helpful. When I came up with this idea, I thought, will people actually be interested in that? And it turned out they are.
Once the Live Forever feature happens, do you want to do it?
Absolutely.
It goes to...
I would love to have myself performing when I'm not around. Like a DJ that's going all the time. Your personality, and it made your judgment calls on what song's next and how to mix it in. That would be so amazing.
Grandkids, great grandkids, you know, just down the line being able to come kick it, you know, and see what the our personality was like in the time we were around.
Sure, it's not for everyone to say, oh my God, do I want to live forever? Do I want to meet my grandfather who is an AI? I don't know. But those who will want to have that, they will be able to. It's incredible to even think what will be possible, to be honest.
So we're both gonna go in VR now.
Bye.
I can't test Artur's idea yet, so all I can do is imagine it. It's just clouds and pods of whales. It's kind of nice. I could see this being a nice digital afterlife.
At least I'm with you.
Maybe we'll have a home where we live with our clone family, where our future descendants come to visit for the holidays. And far into the future, maybe our digital avatars will go out on their own quest to figure out what will happen at their end.
Oh my gosh, it's so cool in here. I don't know how to climb this rock, though.
And hopefully, our clones will learn how to climb rocks.
Hi.
So just hold me.
Okay. Just gonna slow dance in the clouds.
These technologies can't turn back time or heal you. What they offer is simple, a private, unjudgmental space to allow yourself to say what needs to be said. Not to get through it, but to work at it. By going through this process, it's less frightening for me to think that after someone I love is gone, that I can still hold on to some part of them outside of memories. With these technologies, I can ask for advice when I'm scared about the future, hear them tell a story again, or say goodbye one last time. As for what they say back,
it's a wrap.
It doesn't really matter.
For Brendan, have a look. He has full body tracking on, so his movements in real life are.
That's my body.
Oh,
that's my body.
Do you have a Tesla suit on?